Thank you very much for the very kind introduction. And I must say I'm highly impressed by the occasion here of being here in the Ferrari environments. And thanks to Luca, I have the opportunity to visit the museum. And Jack was already saying, you seem so impressed, you took so many pictures, but they're all for my son, you should realize. Yeah. That's a good thing of being a geneticist. You can always blame it on your children. That's no point in that. But in fact, I would like to elaborate a bit on the cars. And here you see two cars. One of them has an energy deficit. I wonder which one you think that would be. Well, being in Italy, it is obvious the right one, which is the one which always has complaints with the motor. And unfortunately, we have a Dutch driver who is quite a good driver, but who has a poor car. And that's basically my line along the talk. A mitochondrial patient is a good person in a wrong energy requirement. So I hope that I can convince you on that. So what I first like to do is a little bit explain to you the mitochondrial genetics. I will not repeat what Martin has already explained so nicely, but I will just go a little bit on what can go wrong in the mitochondria, leading to energy failure and to a collapse. And if you look at mitochondrial diseases, that is diseases which mainly affect the organs or systems which are high energy requirement. So you can have the nervous system, you can have the muscles, the heart, the ears, the eyes. So there are many different organs or tissues which are affected by mitochondrial dysfunction. And coming back to the title of my talk, it can be generally, yes, so there can be multiple systems affected, but it can also be locally, and that's depicted on the right. So there's a patient with Leber hereditary optic neuropathy, so they only have a problem with seeing, and then they see along the edges of their sight. But basically, the paradigm is that any tissue, any system, at any age can occur. And mitochondrial diseases are not that rare. They occur in 1 in 5 to 10,000 of individuals. And we have specific syndromes, but we have also quite common features like deafness, cardiomyopathy, eye problems, which also can have many other causes, both genetic and non-genetic, which make it sometimes difficult to find the clue. And this is the many faces of mitochondrial disease. If you look on the internet, there's so many things on the left corner and below. You see the droopy eyelids, you see the people, the patients needing support in walking. This is a person who always is tired when he wakes up. And we are all worth a cure. And that's the biggest challenge at this moment. The genetics is going very fast. We are able to identify the genetic cause in many of the patients, but the patients themselves, they don't benefit from that at this stage, so we have to work on that quite sincerely. So the mitochondria, you have seen this already, so there are the mitochondrial DNAs in the mitochondrial, they produce the cellular energy. A part of the proteins is encoded by the mitochondrial DNA, so it's a few structural subunits, but the vast majority is in the nucleus. And when the symbiosis occurred, most of the genes which were in the symbiont, they were moved to the nuclear DNA. Most likely that because with the symbiont, the ROS production was introduced in the cell, damaging its own genome, and a safe way of getting around it was to go to the nucleus. Why a few proteins has escaped and are still there, that was the discussion in the beginning. It could be that they are very difficult to import, they are very hydrophobic, so it might be that it's easier to synthesize them on the in situ than to have them imported. And obviously that's also a challenge when trying to develop treatment. But most of the genes, 1500 genes, are in the nucleus and they all code different factors involved in mitochondrial function. So it can be structural subunits, assembly factors, translation factors. And in all of these genes, there may be defects leading to mitochondrial disease. You've seen this one, the mitochondrial DNA and the inheritance pattern. So the mitochondria go through the mother, and the nuclear DNA you get from both parents. The frequency of mitochondrial DNA disease, as I said, is 1 in 5,000. But if you look at the populations, mutations in the mitochondrial DNA, they are far more frequent. They are there in 1 in 200 to 400, and usually at a very low level, which means that they are there, but they don't lead to dysfunction. The heteroplasmy has been explained, so you have a threshold where you can lead to the disease. So you see it here, the homoplasmic state and the heteroplasmic state. You should realize that the threshold can vary among tissues, so that's dependent on the energy requirement of the tissue. It can change in time, so in blood you sometimes lose mutations, which are very well there in muscle, which is obviously an issue with diagnostics. And the relation between the mutation load and the clinical symptoms is often not straightforward. So it's quite difficult from a mutation load to predict what the patient will develop. Well, how are we going to find the genetic defect in mitochondrial disease? And this is Max Verstappen trying to find out what is wrong in his car. So that is where he's trying to get an eye on. Well, this is something you cannot read, but it's also, we don't use it anymore, so there's no need to read it. But what we initially would do is we would look at the clinic, we look at the biochemistry, and based on that, we would develop specific tests based on the most likely gene or genetic defect being involved. That led to very complex algorithms, which were quite costly because they took quite some clinical investigation, some laboratory tests to really go to the genetic defect. And by this approach, we were able to solve at about 25% of our cases. Today, we don't do that anymore. The speed in sequencing technology has so much increased that it's much more easier to go for the mutation by exploring all the mitochondrial DNA or all the genes. So the approach in finding a defect or the cause of a disease of a mitochondrial patient is to look at the genetics first. So we have a three-step procedure. First, we look by the mitochondrial DNA. It's all NGS-based. We do some candidate gene analysis if there's a reason for having a rapid test, and that might be because it's necessary for treatment. And the other causes we just see by sequencing all the genes. I will guide you through it quite quickly because I think the technology has been explained already some moments. So here you have the mitochondrial DNA. We PCR amplify it in one or three pieces. It's a bit up to the people how they will do it. You make a library, you cluster them, you amplify them, and you sequence them. And depending on your question, you change the sequencing depth. Like Claudia, she wants to pick up low percentages, so you have to have a high depth. If you look at homoplasmic variants or haplogroups, you can get away with the low coverage levels, which Dagen was referring to in the others. Well, it looks like this. You get from all the positions, the ATCGs, you get the scores, the numbers, and you can, and that's quite easy, order them on number. And here you have a situation where you have an A and a G on the same spot, 25.9% for the A and, for the G, and for the A, 73.92%. So you see by next-gen sequencing, you get both the variant and immediately the heteroplasmy level, so you know exactly the amount of the mutation. And if you order them by percentage, you see that this is the most likely one, and you have very low heteroplasmy levels below, which might be technical artifacts, but it might also be real variants, because in any of our cells, we have heteroplasmic variants, usually at very low levels. And this is the family where it's connected to. It's a very strange family. It's the M3243A2G mutation. It's a common mutation that can lead to diabetes, to the mitochondrial encephalomyopathy, lactic acidosis and strokes, cardiomyopathy, hearing loss. So what you also see here is that those symptoms can occur at different patients in the family, and all those patients enter the clinic in a different way. Some of them go to the cardiomyopathy, otherwise go to the hearing doctor, some go to internal medicine, and you need a geneticist to make the full picture out of it to see that there is a common ground in here. The levels below, and I'll come back to that later, is the percentage which we measure, and there is a general way of having a more severe disease with a higher level, but it's not always the case, which is depicted here. Here it's 60% in muscle, which is the best prognostic one. Here it's lower. This patient has the full Miller's phenotype, and he is healthy. And the difference is something which would like to attract us to developing therapeutic approaches, but I will come back to that later. Well, how do you prevent the transmission of mitochondrial DNA disease? Well, you can just block it. That's easy. There's a bit of a discussion who is to blame from this situation, but apparently the Ferrari thought, well, the Dutchman, he should not pass. We cannot let that go further, so we block him. The disappointment of this type of strategy is that the Ferraris were also not able to drive anymore, so that it's not the solution we're looking for. So for the genetics, we took another approach. You saw the bottleneck, and Martin explained that very well. And the point is that if you have a mutation in the mitochondrial DNA, you produce oocytes, which can have very low levels of mutated DNA or very high ones, which would either lead to a healthy child or to an affected child. And there's basically three strategies of getting healthy children. It's either prenatal diagnosis, which you only can do if there's a high chance that the fetus will be healthy anyhow, so the chances of having to terminate are low. For the heteroplastic mutations, we can do PGD. I'll come back to that later. And for the homoplastic mutations, we can do mitochondrial replacement therapy. And I will not elaborate on that. Jacques is coming to that later in a different perspective, but the technology is fairly similar. Well, the de novo mutations, well, here you have a number of those families. I just always mention these because you have patients with a very high mutation load, up to above 90%. But the mothers don't carry the mutation. And often in clinic, these parents are counseled that they have a very high recurrence risk because of the high mutation load in the child. But you should counsel them on the mutation load in the mother. And if that is absent, and that was investigated by Suzanne Sullivan, then the chances of having a healthy child are very high. So the chances of recurring is quite low. And usually we do a prenatal test to really prove it, but that is basically what's happening here. But there's a lot of misunderstanding on these type of patients. And if you have a patient with a high mutation load, always check the tissues of the mother and to see if it's really an inherited case or a most likely de novo case. And she looked at in our patients, so we de novo is defined as the mutation being absent in different tissues of the mother, but there's obviously a limit to what you can access from a mother, but that is clear. And the counseling is often incorrectly. And the de novo mutations are not very rare. About 1/5 to 1/4 of all the mitochondrial DNA mutations is de novo. So it's quite an important to really look at the segregation level. And we did not find, except from one mosaic case from the UK, where I think that might also be an issue why Degen is often in conflicts, that he's from Britain, but that is a different situation. But there they have a mosaic situation that is causing it. If you look at the PGD, and that's what we in Maastricht mainly focused on, and we have, well, Joep is sitting here as the chair of the next meeting, but with Jos, Christine, and Emma. The PGD is one way of selecting the embryo, and if you look at the graph of this graph, if you can select the embryos with the low mutation load, then you're fine, then you can discard the other ones, and then you're safe. And that is what we try to do. You can only do that for the heteroplasmic mutations, because homoplasmic mutations, you find them 100%. You have to know the threshold. That is an issue, because many families have their own mutation. You have to know if it's reliable, and you have to be sure that the carrier produces embryo which could be healthy. And basically, we can answer yes to all these questions. So for the threshold, we looked if we could generate a threshold. So for common mutations like this one, you can make a graph which explains the mutation load relative to the clinical symptoms, and Debbie Hellebrekers from our lab worked on that. And you can make a graph and you can say, well, if I stay below a certain level, the chances that the child will be healthy is quite high. We put all the other mutations together because they are too few to do that separately, with the assumption that a certain amount of healthy mitochondria is sufficient to be healthy. That's basically the assumption. And then you end up with a mutation load of 18%, and if you stay below the 18%, then the chances of being healthy is more than 95%, which we think is a reasonable estimate to work with. And by doing this, we could open up PGD for all mutation carriers. And this is just how it looks like. This is a carrier with a number of mutation loads. So this is the 3243 mutation again. This is the levels in urine, in hair, and in blood. And this is all one embryo. It's single cells of a different embryo. If you would take the threshold here, then you see that you have embryos here below the threshold, here below the threshold, here and here as well, I think, yeah, over there. So all of these women produce embryos below the thresholds, and it is just a matter of selecting them. And we think the mitochondrial DNA bottleneck is developed for allowing PGD. That is also some kind of evolutionary explanation you could use for this. The ones can be transferred and then lead to healthy offspring. There is some variation, even in the quiet embryo, where you have already some variation in mutation load, so that might not be all quiet all the way, although you cannot exclude genetic drift as one of the reasons. So these are the families we did in Maastricht. This is an Italian family we got from Luca and where he was involved. It was one family. It was an old Italian woman, but she was apparently quite fertile and managed in two cycles to have healthy children. So this is the cycles we did, 31, 6 were leading to a healthy birth. So how far will PGD bring us? So we can do that for all the heteroplasmic mutations. It's safe and reliable. You have to estimate a cutoff mutation percentage, which we are fairly convinced of that it's okay. Based on the limited cycles we have, we expect that most mutation carriers will have oocytes below this threshold. Again, that's different in England. When we talk with the people from Newcastle, they say, well, we have indeed more cases which we cannot put an embryo back because of the threshold, but that might also be, yeah, they are developing more and more mitochondrial replacement therapy to do that. The exact mutation percentage which could be defined is defined by case-by-case counseling, so parents can decide to have more or less risk, and you can use those graphs very nicely with the anticipation of what people would like to do. You could select for male embryos, then you would eliminate the disease in the future. So if you say, well, we take male children, even though there might be a risk, there's no risk for the further generations. That's an ethical issue, but that's an obvious one. And in the past, trophector derm biopsies, which are more commonly used also for other PGD applications, are also being evaluated for mitochondrial DNA disease. Based on the quiet embryo hypothesis, I would prefer blastomers, I must say, because there you always know that the representativeness is much better. And in the trophic derm, you know that replication has started, so there might be differences occurring. It's not said that that would make it unreliable, but that's something which has to be fully tested before putting it into practice. And it was done in practice twice. Once was successful, and in the other one, it was a misdiagnosis, but apparently some technical issues also apply there, so it's very difficult to put a finger on what was really going on in that case. Coming back to finding the mutations, so I talked about the mitochondrial DNA, the transmission. What we have two other approaches is to look at candidate gene analysis in cases of cure or rapid treatment. So if you have a cause which you can immediately try to cure the patient if you know the disease, or if there is a treatment which the patient might die from if he has a defect in the mitochondrial disease, then you want to know it for sure. And that's happening with the Pol G. So this is a case story. It's just also to show you a little bit of the patient behind the disease. So she was a sportive girl. She was at the age of 15. She played soccer. She hit her head and developed epileptic seizures. She went home with medication, lost sight. Epilepsy returned, got worse. She got MRI abnormalities. She had an epileptic seizure of long time. She was brought to the intensive care, into coma, and she has not been awake since. And this turned out to be a defect in the replication enzyme of the mitochondria. It was the polymerase gamma gene. And the diagnosis was Olpe syndrome. Usually the children die then from liver failure and they get into a status epilepticus, which they don't recover from. It was untreatable, but afterwards it appeared that this syndrome could be triggered by the wrong medication. And that shows you why you should sometimes be very fast in finding the diagnosis. And here is also to show you a bit of the strong variety of mitochondrial defects in leading to clinical symptoms. These are all symptoms connected to the Pol G. So a moment ago I showed you mitochondrial DNA mutation, which has all kind of pathology. And here it's the same for Pol G. So you can have the ulpus, you can have the external ophthalmoplegia, ataxia, polyneuropathy, epilepsy and migraine, and also premature ovarian failure. So that's also something that you should realize that there can be a reason in the replication of the mitochondrial DNA causing this, which would also reflect the copy number importance, which we were discussing in the previous talk, failure to thrive. And there's an environmental interaction. So dapagliflozin, sodium valproate, if you give that to treat the epilepsy, if patients have a defect in this gene, they will die from it. So that's something which we test on epileptic patients to be sure. And it's not a simple test. So these are all the mutations that are found in the genes. These are all the symptoms you can find. And the premature ovarian failure mutation, they are dominant mutations. So if a gene is affected here, it's in the replication part of the gene. And you should realize that. So people should also think about it if they see a patient with this, but also if you have a patient with a dominant mutation, that if women want to have children, that can be an issue for them as well. Well, this is the pathway which Pol G is involved, so this is the replication, and the whole machinery of replication is the Solvich pathway called, so it's the nucleotide metabolism. And I show this because this was recently in the news, also in the UK, the Charlie Gard case. It's a patient with a defect in the mitochondrial nucleotide metabolism, and it's part of this complex. And there was the discussion whether he should get a medication in the US, which was not really proven to help. And the discussion was then at that moment that it was approved when he was not having brain damage, but afterwards when he had brain damage, they said it's an experimental therapy, so that the chances that it might reverse the treatment is quite low. But even the Pope here in Italy, Donald Trump, all important people of the world had said something about it, and it turned out to be a very sad case. But it shows you also the sadness of losing your child because it is not thriving, it's not developing, just because a simple mechanism is not functioning very well, and that is how you replicate your mitochondrial DNA. Now, moving to the other nuclear genes, which we don't know yet by all of them, so we're still finding new genes involved in mitochondria. And as I said in the beginning, it can be up to 1,500, so it might be quite a challenge to find them. So what we do, we sequence all the genes, we look at panels which we know affect the mitochondria, and if we cannot solve them, we look at all the other genes to see if we find a new cause of the disease. It's done by sequencing, it's all exome sequencing, probably you're aware of it, where we have a big genome, but most of it is not known to have a very proper function, so the genes is only 1.5%, and by sequencing the 1.5%, you can sequence all of the coding information of your gene and find most of the mutations in the patient. It's done by capture technology, library prep, amplification, and sequence again. Obviously, if you sequence many genes, you will get many variants, and that is the issue. So if you would compare it to repairing a car, a geneticist, even if you have something wrong with your tubes or your light, we just screen all the parts of the car. And technically that is, it might sound strange, more easy than to look where you have to find a defect. So we screen everything. And then obviously you find deficits in all kind of parts. And in the end we have to trace it back to see what's really going on. Well, that's called data filtering. So if you do an exome, you get about 150,000 variants. And in the end we filter the data that we get on average a few genes. And Well, in genetics, you think there must be rare variants, they must have a strong effect, they should be conserved, they must change the protein in a consistent way. So you have a number of criteria which you can filter these variants very nicely to only very few. And then you can look if it segregates in the family with the disease, and then you can, sometimes you need to make a functional connection to the disease if that's not a known gene. So in this way, and that is basically getting the starting situation for complex heterogeneous disorder, is to start with this, see what the variants are, and then go into a relation with the clinic to see how you can explain the phenotype. We did it for about 180 patients with mitochondrial diseases. In 20% the mitochondrial DNA was involved. In the remaining part, we solved 49% with the exome. So we ended up with a yield of about 70%. I must say in regular patient care it's a bit lower, but this is the things you can reach, and that is a major breakthrough, a major improvement to what we did in the past couple of years. Obviously, if you have a clear indication that it's genetic, either because you have a consanguineous family or a non-consanguineous family with more than one patient, then the chances are even higher. So yes, consequent more than one patient, so you're higher, although not very much higher than on the non-consanguineous side. This is an example of a family we solved with exome sequencing. It's Lee syndrome, so it's a disease where children have a failure to thrive, they lose their appetite, vomit, crying, irritability, poor muscle tone and weak, the respiratory problems, and usually they die at a very young age. And on the MRI, you have some specific abnormalities in the brain, which are fairly characteristic for Lee syndrome. So it's a devastating disorder, and you can see it here. It's a consanguineous family. They lost three of their children on that disease, and all of these children died within 1 month. It's In Holland, we have very many immigrant families having these type of consanguineous diseases, so that might also be in other countries. So we did exome sequencing. We had a bit less variance because we only looked at the regions which the patients shared. There were 258 genes and only one with two pathogenic mutations, and it was a thymine transporter, which introduced thymine into the mitochondria. It co-segregated with the disease. We had two other families I'll show you in a moment with that disease. And we showed functionally that the thymine transport was blocked. And those families now, they can have prenatal diagnosis to prevent the transmission. And that is, especially in regions of Morocco, it's a big issue because we have three families all coming from the same area. And apparently this is a founder mutation in that region. And that's also something we always do. If we find something in the immigrant population, we try to trace it back where it comes from, because there often the technologies of identifying the genetic defects are less developed. And this is very crucial information for them to deal with. So we think, and we could trace it back, we could trace it back to the haplotype that they are all coming from a single founder mutation. And here, well, you see the sadness of the families as well. So it's four children died, three children died. Here was one was a bit longer life, but that had died already. So I showed you a bit the successes of the genetics, and Gert will agree with me that it's quite strong. But didn't we forget the patients? We should do something also about the patient. We should make a hero of the person who has a poor starting position. So, and he can even beat the two Ferrari drivers. So that is something which it happened only once, I must confess, but it was for the Holland. He immediately became Sportsman of the Year in the Netherlands, which is something which is quite. It shows that we are not so well established with Formula One drivers. But what can we do to go that? And I show you two cases how we try to build on therapy, one based on the genetic defects and one more on the stem cell type of therapy, which was suggested a moment ago before this talk, so that is one thing I would go into. So this is the Moroccan family again. So it was a thymine transporter gene, and what we reasoned, if because you have two thymine transporters, one which is blocked and the other one which might be working, so what you could do is either to give more thymine or biotin, which regulates the gene expression. So that would be two ways of increasing that could help. And this is how it's shown here. So here's the transporter. So this is another transporter. One has the high capacity and low affinity, and the other one is the other way around. This one is defect. But apparently by giving more thymine, you can prevent the systems from occurring. And thymine is vitamin B1, and if you have a deficit on that, there is also, you get all kind of problems which can be part neurologically. But it also there, you see that administration of thymine, which is obviously there an issue because they didn't take it. And here you have the same problem because it's not getting where it should go. And that indeed turned to be quite beneficial. So that was investigated by a group in Germany, so that you can fully prevent the clinical symptoms of occurring. If you have this gene defect, if you treat them with high doses of thiamine, and that's life-saving. You should start very early, because if you have the symptoms, and that's the same in the Charlie Gard case, then it doesn't help anymore. So at this moment in time, the patients, if there's suspicion of Leigh syndrome, they give them thiamine, even if you don't know the genetic defect at this moment. And if you know it, indeed, you can then go, you have a reason to continue it, and the children can be healthy. So I think this is always a very nice success story. You have the genetic defect. By the genetic defect, you have the treatment, and the treatment is immediately helpful. But obviously, this is a minority still, and we have to do our best to make that even better. So how are we going to treat the mitochondrial DNA patients? So I just spoke about the nuclear gene defect, so I'm coming now back to this family with the mitochondrial DNA mutation. And part of it is prevention. So I just mentioned to you that this is a person with a certain amount of mutation in muscle and is having the full picture of the meles. And this person has a higher mutation load and is healthy. And Martin told us, well, no, the higher the level is, that the clinical symptoms should occur. But this was a marathon runner. And it apparently is investing in your energy potential is something good. And we see that also in oocytes, in cells. As long as you have sufficient reserves, sufficient amounts, you are able to prevail. And based on that, but if you're already ill, if there's something wrong, and then you're going to train, and that might be a bit of the what we heard in the previous talk, then it doesn't help anymore, because then the toxic effects are bigger than the helpful effects. So you should compensate at a moment that there is no damage. Well, we took that a step further, and what we thought, well, maybe if persons have muscle problems, if we could isolate muscle stem cells, clear them from the mutation, culture them and give them back to the patient, that would be a way of treating at least part of the symptoms they have. It will not be complete. And we thought we had very nice muscle cells. This is the cell type which was detected here in Italy. It was in Milano they worked on that. It was the mesangioblast. These are myogenic stem cells that can proliferate very easily and differentiate into myotubes. They are much better than satellite cells. So that's 10 times higher than iron man. They can proliferate in vitro in 25 passages, so you can culture them easily. And what is also nice, they can cross blood vessels. So you can inject the cells in your blood, and they move to the damaged muscle to treat the muscle, because that is always an issue. How are you going to treat your muscles if you cannot inject everything there? So that is what we said. Well, we can isolate them, we get them mutation-free, expand them, and then intra-arterial transplant them. What, to our surprise, when we looked at the stem cells, and this may be a bit of a busy slide, you see the red crosses. I don't know if they're still red if you look at from the back. So this is the mutation load in muscle. And the other dots are the mutation load in the muscle stem cells. And to our surprise was that there were many stem cells which were mutation-free, despite the fact that in the muscle the mutation load was very high. It was not always the case, so here you have a high mutation load in the muscle and in the stem cells, but many of them were already mutation-free, and that shows you that what we heard also in the beginning of the first talk, there are mechanisms of selection of mutation loads which go up and down, and especially for this mutation, that seems quite well that you can give back the patients their own stem cells, basically. We also worked on this ones, but I didn't have the data with me, but if you do a reprogram to iPS cells, they lose their mutation loads also. So there's also other ways of getting them mutation free. It's also being depicted here. So we have 7 patients, they have high mutation loads in muscle, and the median in the mesangioblast is almost 0, which means that they basically make healthy muscle cells. We also looked at aging people. If you age, you also fragment your mitochondrial DNA, and also even if we get older, our stem cells stay quite healthy, and that is also something which we could use for other purposes. So we looked how these stem cells were normal, so they grew normally, they doubled well, they had a good myogenic capacity, their Oxford function was normal, they had a normal mitochondrial DNA copy number, so that seems that they were purely wild-type cells being in the wrong muscle. So we're now currently preparing for a phase 1-2 clinical trial. We think that those cells fulfill all the requirements to be used as an autologous therapy. So they have used these cells as an allogeneic therapy because from a donor in Duchenne's. The good thing we have is that it's the patient's own cells, so you don't have any immune problems. We have cultured them, so we are finalizing the protocol. We have to bring some damage to the muscle to have them trace them back, that the cells know where to go to, and we hope that we will start in the next couple of years for a trial to see if we can do something on patients having a mitochondrial DNA defect. If these cells would work and you would use that for other muscular diseases, obviously you have to correct the genetic defect, but these approaches are getting more and more popular these days as well. Well, coming back, this is almost my final slide to Max Verstappen. What would be his perspective of becoming a champion? So one way is indeed to change the themes, and that brings me basically to the mitochondrial replacement therapy, which it's a bridge to the next speaker. So you have the good working cells, and you have a good driver in the wrong cell. So there's the wrong mitochondria. What you then need to do is you take the driver out, so the nucleus, and you put it in the good background, so you put them in a Ferrari. You have to get rid, obviously, of the other driver. That might be a simple issue, but that's something we might discuss. But I think that would be the best chances for us, and basically this is the same as mitochondrial replacement therapy works. You put the nucleus in the good background, and you see how it might help. So this is all the people involved, so the people on the PGD in Maastricht, all the people, the PhD students, and I want to thank you for your attention. Thank you. please don't ask anything about cars. Because that
I wouldn't ask anything about cars. So thank you for this very nice presentation. Nice to have some patient perspective also today. So are there any questions from the room?
The whole arena of pharmacogenomics is opening up.
Yeah, absolutely.
How do you see the horizon for that, from your point of view?
Well, pharmacogenomics is always, which has especially also Maastricht, attracted a lot of attention, but never got to the point where you should use it. And I think by doing these sequencing efforts, it's now mostly targeted. For certain compounds, people are tested and see if there's adverse effect. Having these sequences, you could go to the sequence, but maybe Gert wants to comment on that later. There's a difference also in the United States and Europe. In the United States, they feel if you have the sequence information, you should explore everything which could be beneficial for the patient, which obviously was the way how you treat them. In Europe, we are more restricted to finding the cause of the disease the patient is suffering on, which is primarily, but I think in future that will disappear and the pharmacogenomics will become more and more popular. But I never understood why that isn't gone any further than it is now, but maybe, I know Gert Matthijs is here, he's also an expert on that field, maybe he can comment on that, but I don't know if he's still in the audience. But
it's got a huge potential.
No, okay.
Klaus, please.
Thank you very much for your lecture. If you have a threshold embryo, would you reconfirm this result by amniocentesis or CVS?
Yeah, we always offer it, but they never use it. That's always the point. It's very precious pregnancies, and I think for PGD it's not necessary because we have now so much expertise that it's true. But they took the risk initially, and you see the same happening in mitochondrial replacement therapy. I think that if people having there even a minor risk of having a carryover in the whole procedure, it's said that they can have confirmation by prenatal, but I don't think that they will use it.
I had a question, Bert. When you showed that you were testing the percentages of abnormal mitochondria in blood, hair and urine, it seemed, it sort of went away very quickly. It seemed that the urine was like the best predictor of what you can find in an embryo.
Yeah, if you try to find the genetic cause, you try to do that in a way that you can have the tissues which are less invasive for the patient. And for the Mielis mutation, the M3243, which is a common one, they compared muscle with urine. And then they saw that urine was more comparable, so that was comparable with muscle, which is the gold standard. For other mutations, that has not been shown, but it's not said that that's not the case. It's just that you don't have too limited samples to prove that unconvincingly. So, and that's always the case. That was also what we had with we changed now the PGD protocol from 2 blastomeres to 1. We only have enough data on the Mielis mutation, but based on the quiet embryo hypothesis of Degen, we said, well, that would also apply to all the other mutations, because then, but you have to generalize in a certain way, and that might be that you could do that here as well, that you say, well, we can use urine also for others. Yeah.
Point of time.
No, it's okay.
Chair says it's wine.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bert. It was very nice.